This is Peter Terry from the Firm Foundation Academy, and I'm introducing Violeta Zane. Is this going to be our final session?
Yes, it is.
It is. It is going to be our final session for the Extraordinary Life of Abdu'l-Bahá. And this is being brought to you by Firm Foundation Academy, Desert Rose Baha'i Institute, and the Bahá'ís of Clearwater. And we're going to now turn everything over to Violeta Zane, who is going to close out this wonderful program. Thank you.
Welcome, everyone. This is day 13 of the Extraordinary Life of Abdu'l-Bahá. And yesterday, on day 12, we looked at the last 3 years of his life in great detail. The momentous three tablets that Abdu'l-Bahá revealed for the tablets to The Hague and the tablet to Dr. Auguste Forel, three of the weightiest tablets of his ministry. We looked at stories of friendship. We looked at Abdu'l-Bahá bringing electricity to the holy places in the last year of his life. We looked at Baha'u'llah and the new era. We looked at Abdu'l-Bahá meeting a future president of Israel. And this session today is going to focus on the months, weeks, and days, both preceding Abdu'l-Bahá's ascension, and following his ascension. And without further ado, I will share my screen. This is the Extraordinary Life of Abdu'l-Bahá, Part 9, The Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá. This part covers the days, weeks, and months before and after the ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá at the age of 77 on the 28th of November, 1921. Before the ascension. Following some statements made by Abdu'l-Bahá referring to the end of his earthly life, this is a colorized image of Abdu'l-Bahá that was recently made available to the Baha'is of the world by the World Center on the website Baha'i Media Bank. For several years before his passing, and with increasing frequency as the end of his earthly life approached, Abdu'l-Bahá made passing comments about his death, sometimes clear allusions, and at times more subtle references. In preparation for the ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá and this close of such an extraordinary, unparalleled life, we felt it only befitting to follow the example set by Shoghi Effendi in God Passes By and in his joint essay with Lady Blomfield called An Account of the Passing of Abdu'l-Bahá, which you can download in this section of the chronology. This is an attempt to gradually, spiritually prepare ourselves for his passing with a compilation of his statements from several years before 1913 to 1921. Several years before 1913, whether or not I be on earth. This is a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá in front of his home at 7 Haparsim in Haifa. According to Shoghi Effendi, several years before the end of Abdu'l-Bahá's journeys to the West, Abdu'l-Bahá would pen two tablets in which he would allude to his passing. The first one, in part, reads, O ye my faithful loved ones, should at any time afflicting events come to pass in the Holy Land, never feel disturbed or agitated. Fear not, neither grieve, for whatsoever thing happeneth will cause the world of God to be exalted and his divine fragrances to be diffused. In another tablet, around the same time, several years before 1913, remember, whether or not I be on earth, my presence will be with you always. On the 26th of November, 1913, when he is in Ramleh, Egypt, I long for the kingdom of Abha. In Ramleh, on November 26, 1913, Ahmad, Sohrab, and Abdu'l-Bahá are returning home after visiting Bahá'ís. Before they reach their destination, Ahmad Sohrab mentions that a number of believers in some parts of the world have been asking for Abdu'l-Bahá to visit them. Abdu'l-Bahá grows silent and after a minute says, "Oh, my thoughts do not belong to this world and its activities. My thought is diametrically opposed to their thought. They want me to be in their midst, but I long, oh, I so long to be in the kingdom of Abha. There shall I rest. I am waiting for the coming of that auspicious day. Then and now is the time for the believers to arise and perform their services. With greater power and concentration of purpose, they must arise to spread the message of the kingdom. From the kingdom of Abha, I shall look down upon them and confirm them and assist them. No catastrophe must shake their aim. Rest thou assured that I will confirm them, protect and watch over them. I shall live in their hearts forever and ever." On the 10th of December, 1913, in Akka, "The tree of my life hath yielded its fruit." This is another photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá entering Seven Hepersin. While in Akka, on his fifth day back in the Holy Land after his journeys to the West, Abdu'l-Bahá has spent a long day and many hours paying visits to many friends inside Akka. Sitting with several young Baha'is, tired from his efforts, Abdu'l-Bahá addresses the youth with these poignant words, where he empowers them to continue his work. "My work is done. The tree of my life has yielded its fruits. I have set a fire in the world. Your duty is to add to its flame. My sons, it is now your turn. The members of my constitution are well nigh disintegrated. You are young and your blood is pure. Your intelligence is keen. You can bear the difficulties of this life." Around the end of February 1914, "The time is coming when I shall no longer be with you." This is Abdu'l-Bahá in front of his home at Seven Hepersin in Haifa, riding a donkey. Shoghi Effendi tells us that at the end of his strenuous Western tours, where Abdu'l-Bahá had, quote, "called forth the last ounce of his ebbing strength," Abdu'l-Bahá writes to the Baha'is a tablet which contains this excerpt. Hand of the Cause and historian Hassan Baliuzi, on page 405 of Abdu'l-Bahá, the Center of the Covenant of Baha'u'llah, dates this tablet around the end of February 1914. "Friends, the time is coming when I shall no longer be with you. I have done all that could be done. I have served the cause of Baha'u'llah to the utmost of my ability. I have labored day and night and night and day all the years of my life. Oh, how I long to see the believers shouldering the responsibilities of the cause. My days are numbered, and save this, there remains nothing, none other joy for me." Around 1919, "My work is now done upon this plane." This is Fujita standing behind Abdu'l-Bahá, accompanying him on a visit to the old Western pilgrim house across the street from the master's house. According to Shoghi Effendi, Abdu'l-Bahá turns to a distinguished visitor of his, seated by him in his garden, suddenly breaking the silence, and says, "My work is now done upon this plane. It is time for me to pass on to the other world. This is quoted in Shoghi Effendi's very first letter to the Baha'is of America, dated January 21st, 1922. June 1921 or earlier, O Lord, my Lord, hasten my ascension unto thy sublime threshold. You see Abdu'l-Bahá here on the steps of his house at 7 Haparsin. Less than 6 months before his ascension, Abdu'l-Bahá reveals a prayer in honor of a relative of the Bab, in which we read these heartbreaking words. O Lord, my bones are weakened, and the hoar hairs glisten on my head. I have now reached old age, failing in my powers. No strength is left in me wherewith to arise and serve thy loved ones. O Lord, my Lord, hasten my ascension unto thy sublime threshold and my arrival at the door of thy grace beneath the shadow of thy most great mercy. A few weeks before his passing, cable Shoghi Effendi to return at once. This is a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá entering the Eastern Pilgrim House. You can see Shoghi Effendi on the right in dark clothing. Abdu'l-Bahá suddenly enters the room where Shoghi Effendi's father is a few weeks before his ascension and says, cable Shoghi Effendi to return at once. Shoghi Effendi's parents, in consultation with other members of the family, decide that the cable would risk shocking Shoghi Effendi unnecessarily. They opt instead to write a letter conveying this message, which arrives after Abdu'l-Bahá has passed away. Unwittingly, by not strictly obeying Abdu'l-Bahá's directive of sending a cable, they will have caused Shoghi Effendi a lifelong pain. Around the end of September 1921, now that I have uttered the call to prayer, the vast multitudes will of themselves chant the prayer. It's a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá en route to the shrine of the Bab on Mount Carmel. 2 months before his passing, Abdu'l-Bahá tells his family about a dream he's had. I seemed to be standing within a great mosque in the inmost shrine facing the Qibla. This is where Baha'u'llah is buried and where Baha'is turn to pray. In the place of the Imam himself, I became aware that a large number of people were flocking into the mosque, more and yet more crowded in, taking their places in rows behind me until there was a vast multitude. As I stood, I raised loudly the call to prayer. Suddenly, the thought came to me to go forth from the mosque. When I found myself outside, I said within myself, for what reason came I forth not having led the prayer? But it matters not. Now that I have uttered the call to prayer, the vast multitude will of themselves chant the prayer. October 21st, Haifa. October 1921, Haifa, destroy this room. This is a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá's house at 7 Haparsin Street, which is the large building with a flat white roof on the side of the image on the right. The very small building on the left edge of the image is the white gardener's room. The master often used this room during the day where he could see the shrine of the Bab. This here is the small white gardener's room. A few weeks after the end of September 1921, when Abdu'l-Bahá is occupying a solitary room in the garden of his house, he recounts another dream to those around him. I dreamed a dream, and behold, the blessed beauty Baha'u'llah came to me and said, destroy this room. The Baha'is present do not understand the significance of this dream until Abdu'l-Bahá passes away soon after. It then becomes clear to them that by room, Baha'u'llah had meant the temple of Abdu'l-Bahá's body. At the end of October 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá refers to his own passing as a comfort to a bereaved believer. This is a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá in the middle of his garden in Haifa. A month before his ascension, Abdu'l-Bahá refers to his passing expressly in some words of cheer and comfort that he addresses to a believer who was mourning the loss of his brother. Late 1921, in Haifa, for he will eventually take his leave of you all. This is a beautiful vertical photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá. In a rare angle from the back, you see his beautiful hair and his white taj. This photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá in Haifa was taken from the doorway of the small gardener's room on top of the garage at the master's house. The master often used this room during the day where he could see the shrine of the Bab, just visible in the photograph. In one of his last tablets, Abdu'l-Bahá gives last words of advice to the Baha'is. For he will eventually take his leave of you all. Nay, fix your gaze upon the word of God. The loved ones of God must arise with such steadfastness that should in one moment hundreds of souls, even as Abdu'l-Bahá himself, be made a target for the darts of woe, nothing whatsoever shall affect or lessen their service to the cause of God. Early November 1921, Haifa. The hour is come when I must leave everything and take my flight. This photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá was taken in the garden of his house at 7 Haparsim, from under the trellis on the north downhill side of the house. 2 weeks before his passing, Abdu'l-Bahá speaks to his faithful gardener in a way that clearly indicates he knows his end is near. I am so fatigued. The hour has come when I must leave everything and take my flight. I am too weary to walk. It was during the closing days of the Blessed Beauty when I was engaged in gathering together his papers, which were strewn over the sofa in his writing chamber in Bahchi, that he turned to me and said, it is of no use to gather them. I must leave them and flee away. I also have finished my work. I can do nothing more. Therefore, I must leave it and take my departure. Shortly before the master's passing, it is finished. It is finished. This is Abdu'l-Bahá walking up Haparsim with 3 children eating sweets that Abdu'l-Bahá has just given them. Servant Ismail Agha. The master said, I am sick with fatigue. Bring 2 of your oranges for me that I may eat them for your sake. This I did, and he, having eaten them, turned to me, saying, have you any of your sweet lemons? He bade me fetch a few. Whilst I was plucking them, he came over to the tree, saying, nay, but I must gather them with my own hands. Having eaten of the fruit, he turned to me and asked, do you desire anything more? I asked, do you desire anything more? Then with a pathetic gesture of his hands, he touchingly, emphatically, and deliberately said, now it is finished. It is finished. These significant words penetrated my very soul I felt each time he uttered them as if a knife were struck into my heart. I understood his meaning, but never dreamed his end was so nigh. A few days before November 28, 1921 in Haifa, set me free. This is Abdu'l-Bahá in the garden surrounding the shrine of Baha'u'lláh and Bahji, his most beloved of all places. A few days before Abdu'l-Bahá passes away, he shares his longing to leave this world in a tablet addressed to the American believers. I have renounced the world and the people thereof. In the cage of this world, I flutter even as a frightened bird and yearn every day to take my flight unto thy kingdom. Ya Baha'u'llah Bahá, make me drink of the cup of sacrifice and set me free. The Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá, 28th of November, 1921. Saturday and Sunday, 1920, November 1921, the suicide of Mirza Abul Hasan Afnan. This photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá as one of the pallbearers of Mirza Abul Hasan Afnan is one of the last photographs we have ever taken of the master. A very grainy, very cropped version of this photograph was published in Star of the West. This beautiful copy of this image was provided for the chronology courtesy of the National Baha'i Archives of the United States, uncropped and in high definition. The caption on the back of the photograph reads, "The master carrying the funeral of Mirza Abul Hasan Afnan on his shoulders. Photograph taken by Lutfullah Hakim, future member of the Universal House of Justice, 10 days before the master's ascension." Mirza Abul Hasan Afnan, a Persian nobleman and descendant of the family of the Bab, had lived a long time in the Holy Land and was very close and very attached to Abdu'l-Bahá. The master caught a cold on Friday, November 18th, 1921. The next morning, Saturday, November 19th, Mirza Abul Hasan Afnan dismissed his servant, saying he was going away. He had realized Abdu'l-Bahá's passing, the most great calamity, was impending, and he could not bear to live through it. And so this devoted Baha'i wrote a supplication to Abdu'l-Bahá, walked for 2 hours, and arriving at the shore of the Mediterranean, threw himself into the sea. Baha'is brought his body ashore, and on Sunday, November 20th, when the believers were carrying his casket from the house for interment, Abdu'l-Bahá arrived and acted as pallbearer to his dear friend. After this tragedy, Abdu'l-Bahá took great care in advising the Baha'is, "You must not injure yourselves or commit suicide. It is not permissible to do to yourselves what Mirza Hasan Afnan did to himself. Should anyone at any time encounter hard and perplexing times, he must say to himself, this will soon pass. Then he will be calm and quiet. In all my calamity and difficulties, I used to say to myself, this will pass away. Then I became patient. If anyone cannot be patient and cannot endure, and if he wishes to become a martyr, then let him arise in service to the cause of God. It will be better for him if he attains to martyrdom in this path. Arise ye in service to the cause of God as apostles arose after the departure of Christ." Friday, November 25th, 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá's last noonday prayer at the mosque. This is Haifa in 1945 with a mosque in the middle ground. We have no indication which mosque Abdu'l-Bahá attended. Abdu'l-Bahá was greatly fatigued on Friday, November 25th, 4 days before his passing. He nevertheless attended the noonday prayer at the mosque, as had long been his habit. He also distributed alms to the poor after the mosque, again, one of the master's many decades-long customs since the days of Akka. The same day, Friday, 25th of November, morning and lunch with the pilgrims. This is the last photograph ever taken of Abdu'l-Bahá before he passed away in Friday in Haifa. It was taken on the November 18th, 1921. So actually it's the second to last photograph, because the funeral photograph with Mirza Abul Hassan Afnan was taken on the 20th of November. But it's one of the last two pictures ever taken of Abdu'l-Bahá. This is also courtesy of the National Baha'i Archives of the United States. Friday, November 25th would be the last day Abdu'l-Bahá ever attended the usual meetings of the Friends, and the last day most of the pilgrims would ever remember seeing Abdu'l-Bahá. John Bosch remembered later that the last time he had spoken to Abdu'l-Bahá, he had entered the garden. Sorry. A dog just jumped on me.
Ferme bien la porte, maman.
My apologies. You cannot control living beings. Friday, November 25th would be the last day Abdu'l-Bahá ever attended the usual meetings of the Friends, and the last day most of the pilgrims would ever remember seeing Abdu'l-Bahá. John Bosch remembered later that the last time he had spoken to Abdu'l-Bahá, he had entered the garden of the master's house and had seen Abdu'l-Bahá giving instructions to the gardener, walking up and down the garden lanes, like almost any morning, picking oranges here and mandarins there with his own hands and giving them to the visitors. Several Persians, Hindus and Arabs, and when John Bosch appeared, he too got a mandarin, and Abdu'l-Bahá smiled and told him in English, "Eat." At noon, Abdu'l-Bahá came to lunch in the pilgrim house and spoke to several guests. As usual, Abdu'l-Bahá only helped himself to small portions, but heartily encouraged the pilgrims to help themselves to more. When lunch was finished, Abdu'l-Bahá rose from the table and turned to the pilgrims, his hands turned upwards, his face radiant and smiling, and he repeated three times, "Good afternoon, good afternoon, good afternoon." Those were Abdu'l-Bahá's last words to the pilgrims. Friday, November 25th, 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá's last tablet was addressed to his beloved Stuttgart Baha'is. On Friday, November 25th, 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá dictated the very last tablet of his 30,000 tablets to his secretary, Ruhi Effendi. Below is the full text from Star of the West, where this version of this tablet was printed. "O ye beloved of the Lord, in this mortal world, nothing whatsoever endureth. The people of the earth dwell therein and spend a number of days uselessly, ultimately descending beneath the earth, the dust, repairing to the home or eternal silence, leaving behind them no achievement, no blessing, no result, no fruit. All the days of their lives are thus brought to naught, whereas the children of the kingdom sow seeds in the fertile soil of truth that will eventually spring up and bring forth many a harvest and shall forever bestow upon mankind its increase and bountiful grace. They shall obtain eternal life, attain unto the imperishable bounty, and shine even as radiant stars in the firmament of the divine kingdom. The glory of glories rest upon you." Abdu'l-Bahá officiates his beloved and faithful Agha Khosrau's wedding. This photograph shows many important people in Abdu'l-Bahá's life. First, Shoghi Effendi, seated on a cane chair, around 5 or 6 years old. Second, Haji Mirza Haydar Ali, the Angel of Carmel, one of the outstanding Baha'is of that era. Standing on the right with his hand over his heart is Mirza Mahmoudi Zarkani, Abdu'l-Bahá's constant assistant, secretary and diarist throughout his travels to the West. And lastly, the subject of this story below, on the left, Agha Khusraw, an extraordinary character we've had the pleasure of encountering often in this chronology. He was a devoted servant of Abdu'l-Bahá of Burmese descent and clearly dearly beloved by the master, and one whose wedding Abdu'l-Bahá officiates as one of his last earthly acts. One of the things Shoghi Effendi also mentions in God Passes By is Abdu'l-Bahá's insistence on officiating the wedding of one of his servants. Precious details are provided by eyewitnesses. The servant in question was none other than our beloved Agha Khusraw. Agha Khusraw was a constant companion of Abdu'l-Bahá for decades, as we will see. But during Abdu'l-Bahá's travel to the West, he was his cook, and he was known to joke. Agha Khusraw was a cook for Abdu'l-Bahá during his travels to the West, and he was known to joke that for him, Paris, London, everything looked the same because he was inside a kitchen. Because he was the master's cook, he was the one who most often made tea for Abdu'l-Bahá, wherever they were. He was the one who accompanied Abdu'l-Bahá when the master needed to go away for a few days in Aboukir or Ismailia. In Egypt, many stories feature Agha Khusraw. And he was the one who turned back at Naples with Shoghi Effendi when they were on their way to America. So he was not able to travel with Abdu'l-Bahá to America. Agha Khusraw was Burmese, and his life had started a continent away. One day, a Baha'i pilgrim made his way from India to the Holy Land, passed through a slave market, and saw a lost-looking child, about 6 years old, standing on the street block, waiting to be sold. The man was so moved that he actually bought the child and took him to Palestine. Abdu'l-Bahá took in Agha Khusraw, had him brought up inside his own family and educated. And this is the man that Abdu'l-Bahá insists on marrying on Friday, November 25th, 1921. It seems as though there must have been talk of postponing the wedding, because it is clear from several eyewitness accounts that Abdu'l-Bahá insisted not only that the marriage take place that day, but that should his daughters not be able to make the preparations for the wedding, Abdu'l-Bahá would do them himself. The wedding between Agha Khusraw and his Persian bride, the daughter of a martyr, also brought up in prison in Palestine, like Agha Khusraw, took place that very night. And ensuring the wedding took place was one of Abdu'l-Bahá's last earthly acts on behalf of one of his dearest friends. Later that evening, Abdu'l-Bahá blessed Agha Khusraw and his bride and told his old friend, "Khusraw, you have spent your childhood and youth in the service of this house. It is my hope you will grow old under the same roof, ever and always serving God." It is interesting to keep in mind that because this wedding took place less than 48 hours before Abdu'l-Bahá's passing, the house of the master was still full of wedding guests when Abdu'l-Bahá passed away. It is also very poignant to see Abdu'l-Bahá's last gesture from Agha Khusraw's vantage point. Having been so attached to Abdu'l-Bahá since his earliest childhood, the comfort of marriage was the master's last gift to him before his passing. As devastated as Agha Khusraw undoubtedly was, he was not left alone. Saturday, November 26, 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá's treacherous fever. This is the bedroom of Abdu'l-Bahá where he passed away. In the morning of Saturday, November 26th, Abdu'l-Bahá rises early and has tea in the tea room. The master's illness, which started with a cold over a week ago on November 18th, has progressively developed into a fever, and Abdu'l-Bahá starts feeling very cold. The master asks for Bahá'u'lláh's fur-lined coat, a garment he dearly loves and often wears when he is cold or feeling unwell. Abdu'l-Bahá then withdraws from the tea room to his bedroom and lays down on his bed, telling his daughter, Munawwar Khanum, cover me up. I am very cold. Last night, I did not sleep well. I felt cold. This is serious. It is the beginning. Several blankets are put on the bed, and Abdu'l-Bahá asks for Bahá'u'lláh's fur coat, which he had removed, to be placed over him. Abdu'l-Bahá's temperature will keep rising until it reaches 40 degrees Celsius, 104 degrees Fahrenheit. But by evening, the fever lessens and has disappeared in the night. After midnight, Abdu'l-Bahá asked for some tea. The master's ebbing and flowing fever is a heartbreaking reminder of the fever that took Bahá'u'lláh's life some 29 years ago, which also came, grew in intensity, abated, then returned and took his life. Sunday, November 27th, 1921, a seemingly normal day. Here are a group of Western pilgrims in Haifa eating fruit from Abdu'l-Bahá's garden, November 1919. Left to right, George Latimer, Arthur Hathaway, Ruth Randall, Harry Randall, Dr. Esselmont, and Bahi Randall. When Abdu'l-Bahá awakens on Sunday, November 27th, the fever is gone and he seems much better. He says, I'm quite well, and we'll get up as usual and have tea with you in the tea room. After the master dresses, he is persuaded to remain on the sofa in his room. After lunch, Abdu'l-Bahá sends words to the pilgrim, requesting that they celebrate the Day of the Covenant by visiting the shrine of the Bab and attending a feast in honor of the holy day, hosted by a Parsi pilgrim recently arrived from India. At 4 in the afternoon, Abdu'l-Bahá, still on the sofa of his room, calls for the greatest holy leaf in his family, saying, ask my sister and all the family to come and have tea with me. Sunday, 27th of November, 1921, three Haifa notables visit. This man was the mayor of Haifa in 1921, Hassan Bey Shukri. After tea with his family, Abdu'l-Bahá receives with his unfailing courtesy the Mufti of Haifa, the mayor of Haifa, Hassan Bey Shukri, and a Muslim judge who, no doubt concerned about his health, suggests a change of dwelling. The Anafir newspaper of December 6th, 1921, recounts the visit of the notables. In the article, we read that when the visitors suggest the change, his stone house for a wood paneled house out of concern for his health, Abdu'l-Bahá recounts to them his recent premonitory dream and says, I saw in a dream that I should occupy this room and not choose another one. I have now stopped building on the surface of the earth, and I will build within the earth. Then, with perfect courtesy and ignoring his guests pleading that he should remain in his room and rest on the sofa, he walks them all the way to the door to bid them farewell. Sunday, November 27th, 1921, though my body was absent, my spirit was there. Following the Day of the Covenant celebration, Abdu'l-Bahá's four sons-in-law and Ruhi Effendi visit him, telling him, the giver of the feast was unhappy because you were not there. Abdu'l-Bahá's response is fraught with meaning. But I was there. Though my body was absent, my spirit was there in your midst. I was present with the friends at the tomb. The friends must not attach any importance to the absence of my body. In spirit, I am and always shall be with the friends, even though I be far away. This is just a memory of Abdu'l-Bahá on board the Celtic as he sailed from New York City to Liverpool. And this is the banquet given in Abdu'l-Bahá's honor. He is all the way here under the American flag when he was leaving New York. Sunday, 27th of November, 1921, Abdu'l-Bahá's last concern is for his friends. The last visitor of the day on Sunday, November 27th, is the head of police, an Englishman, and Abdu'l-Bahá offers him a silk hand-woven handkerchief and then retires to rest at around 8:30 in the evening. The very last question Abdu'l-Bahá asks in his earthly life, merely 5 hours before his passing, is a thought for the well-being of everyone but himself. Before he finally retires, he asks about the health of every member of the Holy Family, all the pilgrims, and the Baha'i friends in Haifa. When informed that none of them are ill, Abdu'l-Bahá says, "Very good, very good." This is to be Abdu'l-Bahá's last utterance concerning his beloved friends. And he goes to bed after eating a little, saying, "I am quite well," and telling his family to go to bed and rest. Two of his daughters, Ruha and Munawar Khanum, stay with him as Abdu'l-Bahá goes to sleep, very calmly, free of fever. Monday, 28 November 1921, the Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá. Abdu'l-Bahá's room and bed, where he passed away on November 29th, 1921. Abdu'l-Bahá wakes up at 1:15 in the morning on Monday, November 28th. He rises from his bed and walks across his room to a table where he drinks some water. Abdu'l-Bahá removes an outer layer, saying, "I am too warm," and returns to bed. When his daughter Ruha Khanum approaches her father, he is lying peacefully. Abdu'l-Bahá looks into her face and asks her to lift up the mosquito net, saying, "I have difficulty breathing. Give me more air." Abdu'l-Bahá is brought some rose water by one of his two daughters. And after drinking some, he lays down again and is offered food. In a clear voice and giving himself a beautiful look, Abdu'l-Bahá asks, "You wish me to take some food and I am going." Less than a minute later, Abdu'l-Bahá's spirit had winged its way to the Abha kingdom, reunited at long last with his beloved father for all eternity. But the expression on his face was so calm and serene that for a moment, his daughters thought he had fallen asleep. He had gone from the gaze of his loved ones. This is a beautiful photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá with three children in 1912. This paragraph is from Shoghi Effendi and Lady Bloomfield, an account of the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá, about the end of Abdu'l-Bahá's earthly life. He had gone from the gaze of his loved ones. The eyes that had always looked out with loving kindness upon humanity, whether friends or foes, were now closed. The hands that had ever been stretched forth to give alms to the poor and needy, the halt and the maimed, the blind, the orphaned, and the widow had now finished their labor. The feet that with untiring zeal had gone up ceaseless errands for the Lord of compassion were now at rest. The lips that had so eloquently championed the cause of the suffering sons of men were now hushed in silence. The heart that had so powerfully throbbed with wondrous love for the children of God was now stilled. His glorious spirit had passed from the life of earth, from the persecutions of the enemies of righteousness, from the storms and the stress of well-nigh 80 years of indefatigable toil for the good of others. His long martyrdom was ended. The centenary of the Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá. Excuse me. This is a graphic rendering of the Shrine of Abdu'l-Bahá from the Baha'i Media Bank. Abdu'l-Bahá passed away at the age of 77 at 1:30 in the morning on Monday, November 28th, 1921. On November 27th, 2021, at 1:30 in the morning, Baha'is the world over commemorated the centenary of the Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá And it was in honor of this unique, once-in-a-lifetime event that this chronology was created. The funeral of Abdu'l-Bahá. 21st of March, 1909, to Monday, 28th of November, 1921, how Abdu'l-Bahá's burial spot was chosen. This is the interior of the shrine of Abdu'l-Bahá on Mount Carmel from the Baha'i world. In the midst of the devastating shockwave that hits Abdu'l-Bahá's family and friends and the pilgrims in the aftermath of his death, the funeral must nonetheless happen shortly, as is the widespread custom in the Middle East. But Abdu'l-Bahá is the center of the covenant, and he must be buried in a befitting place. After searching through Abdu'l-Bahá's papers, his will and testaments is soon found, but there is still no indication as to where the master should be buried. Bahi'i Hanum is the person on whose shoulders this heavy responsibility falls. This is when Abbas Kuli, the custodian of the Shrine of the Bab, approaches the greatest holy leaf with a 12-year-old story dating to the 21st of March, 1909, when Abdu'l-Bahá had finally laid to rest the remains of the Bab. This is Abbas Kuli speaking to the greatest holy leaf and quoted by Michael V. Day in his book, Journey to a Mountain, the biography of the Shrine of the Bab. On the day you came up to the shrine for the interment of the remains of the Bab, Abdu'l-Bahá indicated a place for himself. After he had interred the holy remains in their eternal place, he stepped from the vault into a passageway and ordered the opening to be closed. Pointing to the passageway, he said, "And this should be a place for us." The greatest holy leaf said, "Very well." She blessed him for what he had said and stated, "This is where it will be." The greatest holy leaf selects the vault, according to Abbas Kuli's indication, under the central northern room of the Shrine of the Bab as the place for Abdu'l-Bahá's resting place. If you have visited the shrine or have seen a photograph of the shrine, the Shrine of Abdu'l-Bahá and his vault are next door to the Shrine of the Bab and his vault. This decision of Abdu'l-Bahá's resting place, this most important of all decisions, at the time of the passing of the center of the covenant, is a testament to the greatest holy leaf's uncommon strength of character and leadership. Monday, 28 November 1921, preparations for the burial. This is a photograph of relics of Baha'u'llah, which includes some of Baha'u'llah's headgear. According to Baha'i law, Abdu'l-Bahá's body was washed and wrapped in five separate folds of white silk. A black mitr, a particular type of headgear, often worn by religious leaders and a gift from Baha'u'llah to Abdu'l-Bahá, is placed on his head, and the master's body left undisturbed until the funeral the following morning. The Western pilgrims, the only people outside of Abdu'l-Bahá's immediate family, are permitted to see Abdu'l-Bahá one last time. The news of Abdu'l-Bahá's ascension shocks the world. These are the words of Shoghi Effendi in God Passes By. The news of Abdu'l-Bahá's passing, so sudden, so unexpected, spreads like wildfire throughout Haifa and is flashed instantly over the wires to distant parts of the globe, stunning with grief the community, the followers of Baha'u'llah in East and West. Messages from far and near, from high and low alike, through cablegrams and letters, pour in, conveying expressions of praise, devotion, anguish, and of sympathy to the members of Abdu'l-Bahá's inconsolable family. Here are the condolence messages from around the world mentioned by Shoghi Effendi in God Passes By. Sir Winston Churchill, British Secretary of State for the Colonies, immediately telegraphed Sir Herbert Samuel and instructed him to convey to the Baha'i community on behalf of His Majesty's government their sympathy and condolence. Viscount Allenby, High Commissioner for Egypt, wired Sir Herbert Samuel, the High Commissioner for Palestine, and asked him to convey to the relatives of the late Sir Abdu'l-Bahá Abbas Effendi and to the Baha'i community sincere sympathy in the loss of their revered leader. Abdul Rahman Al-Gailani, the Council of Ministers in Baghdad, instructed him the first prime minister of Iraq to extend their sympathy to the family for His Holiness Abdu'l-Bahá and their bereavement. General Sir Walter Norris Congreve addressed a message to Sir Herbert Samuel, conveying his deepest sympathy to the family of the late Sir Abbas Baha'i. Sir Arthur Money, former chief administrator of Palestine and a general, wrote expressing his sadness, his profound respect, and his admiration for Abdu'l-Bahá, as well as his sympathy in the loss which his family had sustained. On Tuesday, November 29th, 1921, soldiers, line, haparsim, and an honor guard. This is the British Commissioner for Palestine and the Mufti of Haifa, along with other notables arriving for the funeral procession. By 7 in the morning on Tuesday, November 29th, 1921, Haifa is at a virtual standstill. The news of Abdu'l-Bahá's passing has shocked the city and its people, and soldiers line both sides of Haparsim Street, some even stationed in the courtyard of the master's house, standing guard. The funeral cortege, this is the casket of Abdu'l-Bahá leaving the master's house and heading uphill on Persian Street through Weinstrasse or Vine Street, now called Hegefen. Abdu'l-Bahá's body is placed in a plain white wood casket by the Baha'is, and the coffin, covered in a simple paisley shawl, is brought out onto the main hall where Muslim, Christian, and Jewish religious leaders gather while the Muslims offer a short prayer. At 9 in the morning, the funeral procession towards the shrine of the Bab begins, and 8 Baha'is lift the casket onto their shoulders, the pallbearers changing frequently because of the long distance to cover. The funeral cortege is led by a guard of honor, courtesy of the city constabulary force, followed by Muslim and Christian Boy Scout troops, and behind them, Muslim choristers chanting verses from the Quran, along with the Mufti of Haifa, Muslim leaders, and Christian clergymen of at least 3 denominations, Roman Catholic, Greek Orthodox, and Anglican. Behind the coffin are the members of the Holy Family, Sir Herbert Samuel, the British High Commissioner for Palestine, Sir Ronald Storrs, civil governor of Jerusalem and Judea, and Lieutenant Colonel Stuart Symes, the governor of Phoenicia. They are followed by the Haifa consuls for several countries, along with Palestinian, Muslim, Jewish, Christian, Druze, Egyptian, Greek, Turk, Arab, Kurd, European, and American notables. Themselves followed by nearly 10,000 people walking behind the funeral cortege to honor Abdu'l-Bahá. It takes 2 hours for the funeral cortege to make its way through the streets of Haifa, midway up Mount Carmel to the Shrine of the Bab, a distance of about 1 mile, or 1.5 kilometers. A public demonstration of respect of this magnitude from all strata of Haifa and Palestine is nothing short of astounding. And at the same time, it is the most befitting tribute of unity for Abdu'l-Bahá. British officials will later testify to the crowds and the spirit of the funeral cortege, Sir Herbert Samuel saying, "A great throng has gathered together, sorrowing for his death, but rejoicing also for his life." And Sir Ronald Storrs would later say, "I have never known a more united expression of regret and respect than that which was called forth by the utter simplicity of the ceremony." The funeral. This is when the funeral procession has arrived, You see here a absolutely incredible photograph from the National Archives of the United States of America of men and boys standing on the roof of the shrine of the Bab to hear the funeral orations. The procession stops a few meters away from the shrine, and Abdu'l-Bahá's coffin is placed on a cloth-covered table while mourners surround it, while nine eloquent funeral orations are spoken by Muslim, Christian, and Jewish notables of Haifa, as well as Colonel Symes. After the funeral orations, Sir Herbert Samuel, the British High Commissioner for Palestine, approaches the casket and, head bowed, facing the shrine of the Bab, pays his last homage of farewell to Abdu'l-Bahá. The other members of British government follow Sir Herbert Samuel's example, and the coffin is then taken into the shrine. Excuse me. This is the entrance to the Shrine of the Bab, showing the door to the Shrine of Abdu'l-Bahá in the foreground here, and the door to the Shrine of the Bab next to it. Later in the evening of Tuesday, 29th of November, Abdu'l-Bahá's casket is brought to the underground vault of the shrine. The master's casket is oriented so as to face Bahji, where the Shrine of Baha'u'llah is located, and placed in such a way that it is not in front of the sarcophagus containing the remains of the Bab. Rahmatullah Najaf Abadi, the caretaker of the Shrine of the Bab, is so physically strong that he is able to lower Abdu'l-Bahá's casket single-handedly without any trouble. He easily lifts the casket and carries it down to the crypt by himself. After the funeral, he will remember Abdu'l-Bahá asking him a puzzling question some time before he passed away. Abdu'l-Bahá asked Rahmatullah, "You're a strong man. Could you carry me away to a place I could rest? I'm tired of this world." The Tablet of Visitation of Abdu'l-Bahá. This is a beautiful portrait of Abdu'l-Bahá taken in New York in 1912. It was Abdu'l-Bahá who composed the Tablet of Visitation that Baha'is say in their honor. It is also used in private prayer and when Baha'is visit his shrine. The prefatory note of this prayer was also written by Abdu'l-Bahá, and he states about the tablet, "Whoso reciteth this prayer with loneliness and fervor will bring gladness and joy to the heart of his servant. It will be even as meeting him face to face." You can listen to the version in Arabic, the original version of this tablet, on the Utterance Project and on the chronology if you click on this graphic. This is the size of Abdu'l-Bahá's funeral cortege. This is one person, and this is what 10,000 people look like. This is the route of the cortege, the streets it took, where it went, with photographs for every stage that were all provided by the Baha'i National Archives for the National Spiritual Assembly of the Baha'is of the United States. This map was created in collaboration with Baha'i author Michael V. Day, and I encourage you to discover more details about this in his book, Journey to a Mountain. And this is the photo essay, which I'm going to just briefly comment. This is the casket leaving the home, down the steps, being carried through the streets. This is a very wonderful photograph that the National Archives of the United States sent us. You can see the Boy Scouts here, And you can see them holding sticks to keep the people in an organized fashion climbing up the mountain. I invite you to visit this chronology and take your time looking at the individual captions for each. If you click on each, here, for example, this is the funeral cortege on Mount Carmel. Here is close-up of the previous photographs centered around the casket of Abdu'l-Bahá. This is the funeral cortege pauses briefly in front of Abbas Kuli's home, 50 meters from the shrine of the Bab. So when you hover over each image, there is a separate caption that reads. I'm going to very briefly read one or two lines from each of these orations because they are very, 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 very long. And part of this chronology was created as an archive where if you wanted any detail about the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá, whether it be the newspaper articles, whether it be the photos of the cortege or all of the speeches, I didn't want to edit anything. I wanted it to be there for people when they wanted to plunge into that and remember Abdu'l-Bahá through the words of the people who are remembering him. So I'm going to just choose a line here and there. All of the people who spoke at Abdu'l-Bahá's funeral were not Baha'i. The Baha'is did not speak. First speaker was Yusuf al-Khatib, and he was a very well-known Muslim orator. And every single one of these funeral tributes was so beautiful. I mean, at the end, Yusuf al-Khatib says, endure and be patient, for no man, be he of the East, of the West, can ever comfort you. You know, like the loss is so great. And he says, look to your left, look to your right, look to your east, look to your west, and behold, what glory and greatness have vanished. The absence of Abdu'l-Bahá. It's a poem on the absence of Abdu'l-Bahá. The second speaker is a celebrated Christian writer named Ibrahim Effendi Nasser. And he is very emotional. He says, I weep for the world and that my Lord hath died. So you understand that all of these people who are giving these funeral orations had appropriated Abdu'l-Bahá. And throughout all of their tributes, you feel their love for him. He says, hear me, O people, Abbas is not dead. Neither has the light of Bahá been extinguished. Nay, nay, this light shall shine with everlasting splendor. How much Abdu'l-Bahá had touched all of these lives. Then the Mufti of Haifa speaks and he says, O thou revered voyager, thou hast lived greatly and hast died greatly. This great funeral procession is but a glorious proof of thy greatness in thy life and in thy death. Then a distinguished Muslim, Abdullah Muklish, has a very poetic, very, very poetic. He begins and says, have you seen the sunset, the disappearance of the moon and the falling of the stars? Have you heard of the crumbling of the thrones, the leveling of the mountains? In the next paragraph, he answers, yes, the sun of knowledge has set. Yes, the moon of virtues has disappeared. Yes, the throne of glory hath crumbled and the mountain of kindness is leveled by the departure of this benevolent one. The fifth speaker recites a poem that he composed, a short poem. Calls Abdu'l-Bahá the Lord of Virtues, Perfections, and Wisdom. And he calls him the one who was the eye of all time. He planted favors in his sublime rose garden. They grew and bore sweet fruits. The sixth speaker is a leader of the Greek Orthodox Church of Haifa. And he mentions Abdu'l-Bahá's philanthropic deeds. And then there's a young Christian poet, Wadi Effendi Bistani, who recites a long poem. And makes a connection Abdu'l-Bahá, I think, would have really appreciated, because Abdu'l-Bahá loved the Holy Land because it was the location of the shrine of Baha'u'llah, his favorite place on earth. But he also really loved Jesus Christ and anything associated with Jesus Christ ministry. And this Christian poet understood this, and he says, "Thou hast departed in the Holy Land wherein Christian Christ and the Virgin Mary lived, and the land that received Muhammad." You know, so these people knew Abdu'l-Bahá well and loved him dearly. The eighth speaker is a progressive Jewish leader in Haifa, Solomon Buzgalo. And they're all so different and complementary. This one is very modern. In a century of exaggerated positivism and unbridled materialism, it is astonishing and rare to find a philosopher of great scope, such as the lamented Abdu'l-Bahá Abbas, speak to our hearts, to our feelings, and especially seek to educate our soul by inculcating in us the most beautiful principles, which are recognized as the basis of all religion and of all morality. You see, so you have poems, and then you have different denominations, and everyone is really informed by their own experience of Abdu'l-Bahá. The ninth speaker is Sheikh Asad Shukair, a prominent Muslim scholar and statesman. And he has a very historical talk. He goes back into history. And he calls Abdu'l-Bahá an inhabitant of Akka because he lived there more than 40 years. And he talks about his meetings and his philosophy and his philanthropies and his charity and his generosity and what he did in the winter and when he moved to Haifa and when he went to Europe. And so he does like a miniature biography of Abdu'l-Bahá, and every single tribute is very different. Then Muhammad Effendi Safadi recites a poem that he has composed. And I'll just read the opening line. "On Sunday night, heaven was opened and the spirit of Abdu'l-Bahá flew with its glory. It was received and entertained by the prophets. He was washed by the waters of paradise." Media coverage of Abdu'l-Bahá's passing is extraordinary. And this part is really very special to me because when I was very young, I must have been a teenager in high school, I first read God Passes By section on the Ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá. And I remember thinking, I would really like to see these articles one day. And so this is just a little gift to myself and to you. These are the, Abdu'l-Bahá mentions six newspapers. He calls attention to six newspapers that published on Abdu'l-Bahá's passing. And the newspapers, so he says, "Many and diverse newspapers such as," and these are the mastheads of all six newspapers. You can follow along. "Many and diverse newspapers such as the London Times, the Morning Post, the Daily Mail, the New York World, Le Temps, the Times of India, and others in different languages and countries paid tribute to the one who had rendered the cause of human brotherhood and peace such signal and imperishable services." And so here they are, and you can go and read them. This is the Times, the first one mentioned, and then this is the Morning Post, and it's a kind of like an excerpt, you know? It's an excerpt of the Times. And then this is the Daily Mail. This is the New York World, which has a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá. This is Le Temps in French. This is the Times of India. And then this is a collaboration with Nejati Alkan. I contacted him and said, "So what about in the Middle East?" And so there are six newspapers that Dr. Alkan sent me. And you can see that his death was reported in Anafir, the Bugle in Haifa, Palestine, on the 29th of November, 1921, in the language of the Arab in Jerusalem, Palestine, in El Carmel, the Carmel in Haifa, Palestine, in Palestine, Yaffa, Palestine, 30th of November, 1921, and in Itkam, in Dever, in Istanbul, Turkey, on the 9th of December, 1921, and also in Ijtihad, Independent Reasoning, Istanbul, Turkey, 15th of February, 1922, also with a photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá. But this is really kind of it was really reported everywhere, you know? This is the full text of the most common obituary, but look at all the headlines everywhere. Baha'i leader dies, Baha dies in Palestine, Abdu'l-Bahá dies, leader of Baha'i taken by death, head of the Baha'i movement is dead, Abdu'l-Bahá Abbas gone, Syrian leader dead, Abdu'l-Bahá Abbas is dead at Haifa, man who advocated religious unity dies. I mean, he was a world figure. He was a world figure. There was a special edition of Star of the West, of course, after the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá. And the first page was reversed colors, white on black instead of black on white. And there was a tablet of visitation by Baha'u'lláh, then a copy of the cable that Bahiyya Khanum sent out, which reads, His Holiness Abdu'l-Bahá ascended to Abha Kingdom, inform friends, greatest holy leaf. And this is one of the last pictures of Abdu'l-Bahá walking up to his tomb, to the tomb of the Bab. Another photograph of Abdu'l-Bahá with his date of birth and death. And then after all the news articles, after the funeral, come what comes after a funeral. And what comes first after a funeral is the period of mourning, 9 days of mourning. And the first week following the ascension these 9 days of mourning were really intense period of mourning for the people of Akka. Between 50 and 100 of the poor of Haifa come to Abdu'l-Bahá's home to pay their respects, and many stay overnight and are welcomed, received, and fed by the Holy Family. And when I say all of these things are happening, you have to remember that Shoghi Effendi is not in Haifa yet. He's coming. He's now been informed. Instead of coming weeks and weeks ago when Abdu'l-Bahá had asked for him to come, the family disobeyed his orders and he received a letter too late and he saw the cable, which we're going to get to in a little bit. And everything, organizing the wake, organizing the funeral, deciding on the burial place, all of everything that happens right now is resting on the shoulders of the greatest holy leaf. She is the only one that has any authority right now between the center of the covenant having died and the guardian of the faith not having arrived yet. So this period of mourning where the 50 to 100 of the poor come every night takes place in the same spot where it had traditionally been the custom of Abdu'l-Bahá, the father of the poor, to give alms to the needy and the destitute. The grief of Haifa's poor at losing their beloved Abdu'l-Bahá is heart-wrenching to the eyewitnesses of the time. Louise Bosch, an American pilgrim, remembers that they are all weeping bitterly. She describes the grieving pain of the greatest holy leaf, Munire Khanum, Abdu'l-Bahá's widow, and her four daughters, Ziyai Khanum, Tuba Khanum, Ruha Khanum, and Munawar Khanum. Only receiving these throngs of broken-hearted friends of Abdu'l-Bahá, but also speaking with them, being embraced and kissed, and especially being bewailed by the visitors in a custom where the more honored the deceased, the longer and louder the weeping and wailing of the mourners. Throughout the day, tablets are chanted to the mourners. The seventh day following the ascension, and this, my friends, is a real privilege. This is a photograph that was shared by the National Archives of the Baha'is of the United States of America. Baha'i friends ready to give corn, and the poor of Haifa ready to receive the corn on the seventh day after the mourning. This picture was taken on December 5th, 1921 by future member of the House of Justice, Lutfullah Hakim. And here you have a photograph of the poor of Haifa. See how heavy these bags are? See this man who is straining to carry this bag? This is how much corn and wheat was in these bags that was given to the poor of Haifa on the seventh day after the ascension. They received corn and wheat in Abdu'l-Bahá's memory. 1,000 people received corn and wheat, irrespective of creed or race, in honor of Abdu'l-Bahá. On the 7th of December, 1921, the ninth day following the ascension, this is also an exceptional. The next two pictures are also from the National Baha'i Archives of the United States. They show, the first picture here shows Baha'i pilgrims and residents on their way from Akat Bahchi on the ninth day after the ascension on December 7th, 1921. This photograph was taken halfway between Akka and Bahchi, which can be seen in the distance. It's the green spot in the distance. And this photograph is the same Baha'i pilgrims and residents after having paid their respects at the shrine of Baha'u'llah on the ninth day. And now we come to the power of the covenant, friends. The same thing that happened after the death of the Bab, the ascension of Baha'u'llah, the martyrdom of the Bab, the ascension of Baha'u'llah, and the ascension of Abdu'l-Bahá. Is the power of the covenant. We're going to talk a little bit about the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá. 29th of November, Shoghi Effendi learns of Abdu'l-Bahá's passing. This is a photograph of Shoghi Effendi at the time that he attended Oxford University. The failure of Abdu'l-Bahá's family to instantly obey the master's request and cable Shoghi Effendi to return home immediately, some weeks before his passing, had a catastrophic effect on the 24-year-old Shoghi Effendi, deeply attached to his beloved grandfather. He finds out the most devastating news of his life in the worst possible way on November 29th, 1921, when his eyes happened to fall on an opened cable from the Greatest Holy Leaf in Wellesley Tudor Pole's office where he had been summoned. Shoghi Effendi collapses from the shock. The cable reads, "His Holiness Abdu'l-Bahá, Ascended Abha Kingdom. Inform friends." Shoghi Effendi, Abdu'l-Bahá's very own grandson, finds out about the master's passing the same way every other Baha'i found out. The guardian, grandson of Abdu'l-Bahá, found out the way everybody found out. The tremendous shock is so overwhelming to Shoghi Effendi's body, mind, and soul that he is unable to move for a few days. A month later, on the 29th of December, 1921, he arrives in Haifa. This is a photograph of Shoghi Effendi around 1918, 3 years prior to his becoming the guardian of the faith. Beyond the emotional shock he has endured, Shoghi Effendi is unable to travel immediately to the Holy Land because of passport problems. He's finally able to leave England and set sail on December 16th, 1921, arriving in Haifa on December 29th, 1921, accompanied by Lady Blomfield and his sister Ruhangis, who had been studying in Scotland. He arrives exactly 1 month after the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá. The agony of bereavement has taken its toll on Shoghi Effendi, and he is broken by grief, so frail that he has to be held up the stairs of the master's house upon his arrival. Shoghi Effendi is so devastated by Abdu'l-Bahá's absence from the home that he is confined to bed for several days. Shoghi Effendi is read Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament. This is a very beautiful picture of Shoghi Effendi showing his very beautiful hands. This is the guardian of the Baha'i faith in 1921. Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament is first read to Shoghi Effendi in the days following his arrival in the Holy Land. Shoghi Effendi had known upon leaving England that Abdu'l-Bahá had left a letter for him in Haifa, but he had no inkling of the contents of that letter, and therefore absolutely no knowledge of the contents of Abdu'l-Bahá's will, naming him as a successor. The appointment came to Shoghi Effendi as a great shock. Abdu'l-Bahá had known about Shoghi Effendi's destiny since his birth and had written his will and testament in three parts during the perilous years of 1901-1908, when Shoghi Effendi was between 4 and 9 years old. That's how old his will and testament was. He knew. To Shoghi Effendi, this is news. Learning of this tremendous responsibility instantly changes him, and he knows more than anyone what the burden entails, which has rested on the shoulders of the Bab, Baha'u'llah, Abdu'l-Bahá and now his own shoulders. And perhaps one of the most poignant sentences of her entire biography, The Priceless Pearl, Ruhia Hanum recalls Shoghi Effendi telling her, "The day they read me the will and testament, I ceased to be a normal human being." Shoghi Effendi is now the guardian of the Baha'i faith. And Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament must now be read publicly. The will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá, the charter of a new world order. Shoghi Effendi, the guardian of the Baha'i faith, characterized the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá as his greatest legacy to posterity and the brightest emanation of his mind. Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament is called the charter of a new world order. These are the opening pages of Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament from Baha'i World News Service. Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament is called the Charter of a New World Order by Shoghi Effendi, because in this document, Abdu'l-Bahá not only unveils the character of the administrative order of the faith, but he also reaffirms its basis, supplements its principles, asserts its indispensability, and enumerates its chief institutions. Shoghi Effendi also referred to Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament as, quote, "this supreme, this infallible organ for the accomplishment of a divine purpose," and as, quote, "an instrument which may be viewed as a charter for the new world order, which is at once the glory and the promise of this most great dispensation." The will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá also contains provisions for the protection of the faith after the passing of the center of the covenant Abdu'l-Bahá, three of which are the following. First, Abdu'l-Bahá appoints his eldest grandson Shoghi Effendi as his successor. Second, he protects Shoghi Effendi from any possible challenge by not only naming him, but unquestioningly elevating his authority above anyone else's. Third, in this momentous document, Abdu'l-Bahá clearly defines the means by which the Universal House of Justice, the supreme governing body of the Baha'i faith instituted by Baha'u'llah, should come into being. If you would like to learn more about Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament, please click either above or on the graphic and you can download Mr. Hassan Balyuzi, Hand of the Cause and Eminent Historian's commentary on the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá, on which this section was partly based. On January 3rd, 1922, first reading of the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá. This is the House of the Master at 7 Haparsim, where the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá will be read for the first time on January 3rd, 1922. On the morning of January 3rd, 1922, Shoghi Effendi visits the shrine of the Bab and the tomb of Abdu'l-Bahá. Later that same day at the House of the Master, Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament is read aloud to 9 men, most of whom are members of the family of Abdu'l-Bahá. These men witness Abdu'l-Bahá's own handwriting, his own seal, his own signature throughout the three documents that compose this will and testament. At Shoghi Effendi's request, a true copy of Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament is made by one of the men present, a Persian Baha'i. If you would like to hear what Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament sounds like in the original mixed Arabic and Persian, you can click on this graphic or you can go to the YouTube channel or the website for the Utterance Project. 3 days later, on the 6th of January, the second reading of Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament. This is read publicly after speeches and tributes in honor of Abdu'l-Bahá at the 40th day memorial feast on 6th January, 1922. The guests from the memorial feast want to hear from the young guardian, Shoghi Effendi himself. But Shoghi Effendi is with the greatest holy leaf in her room, and he is too distressed and overcome to address the guests. Instead, he pens these words: "The shock has been too sudden and grievous for my youthful age to enable me to be present at this gathering of the loved ones of beloved Abdu'l-Bahá. On the 7th of January, 1922, the next day, the third reading of Abdu'l-Bahá's Will and Testament, the day after the memorial feast, but this time it's an audience composed entirely of Baha'is. The assembled Baha'is hail from Persia, India, Egypt, England, Italy, Germany, America, and Japan. Shoghi Effendi again is not present during this reading, as is his custom. But everyone in the audience rises every time his name is either mentioned in the will or references made to his station or himself. To those assembled, it is clear that the responsibility of leading the faith and its affairs have now fallen on the shoulders of Shoghi Effendi, guardian of the Baha'i faith. That same day, the day after the 40th day feast, provisions of the will and testament of Abdu'l-Bahá are announced to the Persian Baha'is. This is the first National Spiritual Assembly of Iran in 1934. Befittingly, it is the greatest holy leaf, not Shoghi Effendi, who announces to the Baha'i world the provisions of Abdu'l-Bahá's will and testament in two cables. One reads, memorial meetings. This is to Persia. Two cables to Persia on January 7th, 1922. The first one reads, memorial meetings all over the world have been held. The Lord of all the worlds in his will and testament hath revealed his instructions. Copy will be sent, inform believers. The second cable reads, will and testament forwarded, Shoghi Effendi Center cause. On the 16th of January, 1922, and the announcement is made to the United States. This is the National Spiritual Assembly of the United States and Canada in 1931-1932. On January 16th, 1922, the Greatest Holy Leaf sends the following cable to the United States. In will, Shoghi Effendi appointed guardian of cause and head of House of Justice, inform American friends. And this is the covenant of Baha'u'llah. 29th of May, 1892 to the 28th of November, 1921, the end of the ministry of Abdu'l-Bahá and the end of the third epoch and the end of the heroic age of the faith. 28th of November, 1921 to 4th of November, 1957, the start of the guardianship and the inception of the formative age of the Baha'i faith. Now, I just beg your patience for one thing. Okay. 40 days after the ascension. So we looked at this already. This is something we haven't looked at because we were following the will and testament, but I'm going to tell you a little bit about the 40th. This is the picture of Bahi-e-Khanum taken in, there's no date, but she is the sister of Abdu'l-Bahá. And she is the one who kept everyone together until the guardian arrived after the death of Abdu'l-Bahá. An extraordinary woman without peer in history. So I want to just stay on her picture. The 40th day memorial feast is, in accordance with Eastern tradition, an impressive memorial banquet that's held in Abdu'l-Bahá's memory the 40th day after his passing, Friday, January 6th, 1922. Shoghi Effendi's in Haifa already. 650 people from Haifa, Akka, neighboring towns, and as far away as Syria, Lebanon, and Egypt, headed by the governor of Phoenicia, the governor of Haifa, government officials, foreign consuls, anyone, you name it, come to the master's house at 7 Haparsin. A Haifa newspaper enthusiastically reports, neither Haifa nor in any other Oriental city has there ever been such an impressive service. Woo-hoo! The members of the master's household have arranged a perfectly prepared dinner for more than 650 people and 150 of the poor of Haifa who are gathered in a special banquet of their own. The long banquet tables are decorated with trailing branches of bougainvillea, the vibrant purple blooms mingling with the white narcissus, and large dishes filled with golden oranges from the master's own garden. Every single one of these guests receive the same warm welcome into the master's house. These 40th day memorial speeches, this is the house of Abdu'l-Bahá. How lovely is that house? Oh. So many memorial speeches, my friends. I have a lot of information to convey to you. I am not going to read them, but I would like you to visit them at some point. Now, this is something else. I wanted to first tell you. Sorry. I'm going to start with this because I want to finish with Abdu'l-Bahá's outstanding achievements. So these are further resources because there is so much information about Abdu'l-Bahá's passing that I wasn't able to include everything. I included as much and I gave a really good panorama, but there's a lot more things that you can discover. So one good resource, and you can find them all, you don't have to write them down, they're all listed on the chronology, so you could just find them there. The first one, of course, is chapter 21 of God Passes by Shoghi Effendi. That's the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá. The second one is the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá written by Shoghi Effendi and Lady Blomfield. And when you click on any of these graphics here, they will take you to the destination. Hopefully this will take me back to the page where I was, because otherwise I'm in trouble. There you go. So the next one is the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá by Shoghi Effendi and Lady Blomfield. And same thing, if you click on the link below or this, you'll get there. Then there is a special book written by Michael Day called Fragrance of Glory. It's an illustrated account of the weeks preceding and following the passing of Abdu'l-Bahá. And it was published for the centenary. And it has 10 sections, an introduction to Abdu'l-Bahá and his qualities, his last years, the passing, reactions, profiles, the funeral, orations after the funeral, the legacy of Abdu'l-Bahá, and further reading. And it's a nice format. It's a landscape format book. So this is a really wonderful book and a good resource. And this is an example of how information is presented with large, generous photographs. You can also look at chapter 21 of Michael Day in Journey to a Mountain. This is a wonderful, wonderful book. I love this book so much. I really recommend it. And this is the book. You can get it in as an Amazon Kindle book or as a regular book. And there's a lot of details about the interment, which room of the Shrine of the Bab Abdu'l-Bahá's casket first went in, which room it was brought in later. For lovers of Baha'i history, there are tons of details, which opening was used to bring it down. So there's tons and tons of details. There is also a mega, 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 mega compilation by the amazing David Merrick, who does these compilations, and I don't know how he does it. It's absolutely amazing. Every single thing ever written anywhere about the Ascension is going to be in there, and it's massive. So this is beautiful, and it's available online. Then after, of course, you have all my references. I'm very careful to write all my references down for every story. But now, I am going to leave you with the final part in this chronology. And that is the outstanding achievements of Abdu'l-Bahá's ministry. We're going to remember his life and everything he gave us. And this is a thematic compilation that I tried to illustrate from two paragraphs in God Passes By, paragraphs 20 and paragraphs 21. And I tried to give a thematic structure to all of Abdu'l-Bahá's outstanding achievements. So first and foremost, of course, Abdu'l-Bahá's journeys to the West. I'm trying to decide here how much I'm going to read if God passes by. Give me a minute. I will not have enough time because let me explain to you what each image and each theme is followed by an entire paragraph from God passes by. So I think instead of reading it, I'm going to let you go to the chronology and read it yourselves. But I'm going to speak around it and paraphrase what the guardian is saying. I think. Abdu'l-Bahá's journeys to the West. This is Abdu'l-Bahá's heroic achievement after 40 years of imprisonment in Ottoman Palestine. Every single day for 3 years, he was surrounded by people who were writing down what he was doing and saying. He was meeting people incessantly, and he was in his late 60s, early 70s. What Shoghi Effendi says is that Abdu'l-Bahá, quote, manifested before all mankind with a force and in a measure hitherto unapproached its vast potentialities when it empowered him, in whom its spirit and its purpose were enshrined, to embark on a 3-year-long mission to the Western world, a mission so momentous that it deserves to be ranked as the greatest exploit ever associated with his ministry. Victory over the covenant breakers. They occupied this house. Shoghi Effendi calls it Abdu'l-Bahá's triumph over the dark forces which its archbreaker had with such determination arrayed against it. Victories in Europe and America. Its energizing power had soon after been proclaimed through the signal victories which its torchbearers had so rapidly and courageously won in the far-off cities of Western Europe and the United States of America. Safeguarding the unity of the faith worldwide. The indomitable strength of the faith against one of its greatest enemies, but all of them, Nasiruddin Shah too. The downfall of all of these leaders, one after the other, and the victory of the covenant over its enemies. This was one of Abdu'l-Bahá's self-imposed aims for his ministry, the transfer and interment of the remains of the Bab in a mausoleum on Mount Carmel. The growth of the faith in Persia. This is something that's extremely important that often gets... The Persian believers know about this very well, but we need to become more familiar with it because this was definitely one of Abdu'l-Bahá's great, great contributions during his ministry was the development of the administrative order and the faith in Persia, which was the first place on earth where a local assembly was ever elected. And this, despite all these persecutions that rained down on the Iranian Baha'is, the Persian Baha'is throughout Abdu'l-Bahá's ministry, he still managed to be there and to encourage them. Of course, Abdu'l-Bahá's ministry saw the birth of the administrative order. And I just mentioned this, but this is actually a photograph of the very first local spiritual assembly in Baha'i history, the local spiritual assembly of Tehran, which had all four hands of the cause named by Baha'u'llah as its permanent members. And this was one of the hands of the cause here. The first Baha'i house of worship is erected in Ishkaban. Look at the detail outside and inside. It's so beautiful. This was the second stated aim of Abdu'l-Bahá's ministry. Also accomplished brilliantly, despite so many difficulties. With such luxurious details, just absolutely a work of art, an incredible achievement. And Shoghi Effendi is very generous in his description of this achievement. He gives it three long paragraphs. But one perhaps we don't often think of is the expansion of Baha'i literature in the time of Abdu'l-Bahá. He was very involved with the expansion of Baha'i literature and even encouraged books that are introductions to the faith, like Baha'u'llah and the New Era, on top of authoring some books. Tablets of the Divine Plan, we looked at this in great detail yesterday. A significant victory of Abdu'l-Bahá, the first organized plan, and the introduction of faith as far away as Australia during his ministry by both hands of the cause, Clara and Hyde Dunn. Another thing Abdu'l-Bahá did was he restored the house of the Bab in Shiraz. And he kept an eye on the growth of the faith in the Caucasus. After the establishment of the first Baha'i center in Baku, Azerbaijan, and Abdu'l-Bahá sent people there to keep on deepening. And so he took an active interest in growing the faith in the Caucasus, as well as Egypt. Egypt was always very close to Abdu'l-Bahá's heart. And this is actually a photograph of Thornton Chase, the first American Baha'i, and Haji Mirza Haydar Ali, or Mirza Abul Fazl, sorry, Mirza Abul Fazl visiting Egypt in 1907. As well as the growth of the faith in India and Burma. And was having an interesting conversation about Burma yesterday in our discussion session, that Burma is such an isolated place and now called Myanmar. And but it was such an active place. I mean, this is such an isolated place on the Southeast Asian Peninsula. And look at how many Baha'is. Look, they were able to make a sarcophagus for the Bab. I mean, this is an incredible community. And it was lovingly tended to by Abdu'l-Bahá, as well as the growth of the faith in Iraq. So basically all over the world, Iraq, the Caucasus, the United States, Persia, Australia, Azerbaijan, Burma, India, and Iraq. So at least nine places. And of course, the growth of the community in the West. Constant tablets, you know, 30,000 tablets. I know I keep repeating it, but I don't know if you can imagine writing 30,000 letters. I mean, this is how Abdu'l-Bahá visited, and then he kept in touch. And of course, during Abdu'l-Bahá's travels to the United States, he inaugurated and said, the temple is already built. Temple is already built, the second Baha'i house of worship, and historically, the first Baha'i house of worship in the West. So it's doubly important. Abdu'l-Bahá also safeguarded, reinforced the foundations and restored the most great house in Baghdad. And he also increased the properties in the Holy Land, bought more property. And in fact, he had so much property that he could just, like we saw yesterday, give away some property without even asking for compensation back. I mean, Abdu'l-Bahá. And also one should remember that a lot of people who came to the Holy Land to follow Baha'u'llah there and made their lives there, they also bought land and they also gave land to the Center of the Covenant when they passed away. Acres. So yeah, properties in the Holy Land. And of course, we saw yesterday the beginning, the approval of the building of the Western Pilgrim House, which was completed a year after Abdu'l-Bahá's passing, but the land was donated during his lifetime. The Eastern Pilgrim House, the one that's the closest to the Shrine of the Bab, that one was the first to be built. That was completed during Abdu'l-Bahá's lifetime. And of course, the important tablets that we saw yesterday, we covered them in detail. The tablet to Dr. Auguste Forel and the tablets to The Hague. Those were also incredible achievements of Abdu'l-Bahá. And not his knighthood, but the prestige of the faith. How Abdu'l-Bahá single-handedly went from when he was a child, everyone, all of the greatest dictators from Persia to the Ottoman Empire wanted to snuff out the faith from existence, to having Winston Churchill and having his death
mentioned in almost every newspaper in the world. That was done only because of Abdu'l-Bahá's status, station as center of the covenant, and because of his virtues and his personality and his character alone, those alone, and the fact that he was the center of the covenant, brought the fortunes of the faith to such a degree of prestige in just a few decades. Incredible, without having to make any petitions or anything. I mean, Abdu'l-Bahá just did it alone. During his lifetime, Martha Root also began a first historic journey, and that marks a connection between the ministry of Abdu'l-Bahá and the guardianship of Shoghi Effendi, because she will continue to do these historic journeys, fueled by that same passion that was ignited by Abdu'l-Bahá, but she will crown her achievements when she teaches the faith to the first monarch in the world to accept Baha'u'llah, Queen Marie of Romania. Martha Root is incredible. I love this portrait of Abdu'l-Bahá so much. I never like to finish with my own words, so I'm going to just finish with Shoghi Effendi's words. These are two separate quotes from chapters 20 and 21 on Abdu'l-Bahá's ministry. And then I'm going to stop the share and open for questions and comments. These events mark the closing stage of a ministry which sealed the triumph of the heroic age of the Baha'i dispensation, and which will go down in history as one of the most glorious and fruitful periods of the first Baha'i century. Abdu'l-Bahá's great work was now ended. The historic mission which his father had 29 years previously invested him had been gloriously consummated. A memorable chapter in the history of the first Baha'i century had been written. The heroic age of the Baha'i dispensation in which he had participated since its inception, in which he had and played so unique a role, had drawn to a close. He had suffered as no disciple of the faith who had drained the cup of martyrdom had suffered. He had labored as none of its greatest heroes had labored. He had witnessed triumphs such as neither the herald of the faith nor its author had ever witnessed. Thank you. Thank you for being here with me. Thank you for watching on YouTube. Thank you to the Firm Foundation Academy, to Desert Rose Baha'i Institute and the Clearwater Baha'is for your support. And thank you, Peter, for having this idea. I am now going to stop sharing, and we're going to have about 10 minutes of questions or comments to close this. And we won't have another chronology until sometime in the spring. Please pray for me so that I can do a good job on Shoghi Effendi's chronology.
I want to say a word to my friend Violetta that she's very kind to say that it was my idea, but I'm just stubborn.
Good.
And anybody who's dealt with me previously knows I'm a very stubborn person. And so when she said, "Oh, I can't do that," I said, "Oh, well, sure you can. Why not?"
That's true.
Who else is going to do it?
That's true. I did say no.
and basically, I think what happened is she went away, and the angels talked to her and said,
"Yeah,
come on."
Yeah, yeah. My dad talked to me.
Yeah,
my dad.
Your dad
had a great
talked
idea.
To you. He's.
You I basically said no, a flat no. Angels. I'm like, I won't consider it. I'm like, no, yeah. It's like, are you serious? There are 300, 400 and 561 pages. I mean, I can't talk that
yeah.
much.
Exactly.
I said, no.
Exactly. Well,
yeah, it's good. I love that quality. All my favorite people are very stubborn.
Yeah. Well, and so, look, this is, one of the reasons why I believed in this, and I've been encouraging you all the way, this is just the beginning as far as I'm concerned, is because this is a new way of doing things. Way of doing things that is really, really effective emotionally and intellectually.
I don't want these kinds of comments.
we learn a whole lot better when we're listening and seeing at the same time. Okay. That's why we all go to the movies. That's why we sit in front of the television for hours. We love absorbing multiple sensory inputs at the same time. It really, really makes a huge difference. And when you consider this was largely not possible until the 20th century. Because most people only had, they didn't have this richness of being able to have the visual and the auditory at the same time. If you go back a few centuries, everybody got their information from somebody telling it to them. They didn't read. There's still places in the world, like I'm sure in your country, where there are very large numbers of people who don't read at all. Mm-hmm. And we're getting there in America. We're trying to go back to that good way of doing things, right? Mm-hmm. Where we don't read anymore. I'm being facetious, but this is an extraordinary thing, and we need to understand that it's gonna do something for our brains that our brains couldn't do before. It's going to open up possibilities for us to remember things and to care about.
Oh, I see what you mean. Yeah, okay. I'm a little uncomfortable at all of these nice things. It's making me itch. I think that I have to just put my ego aside a little bit and think that actually the if it is efficient for history and for people's connection to Baha'u'llah and their personal relationship with Baha'u'llah, if this is efficient, even though it requires me putting my face on something for so long, which is really uncomfortable for me, but if it is efficient, then it is. I accept your analysis, and I think that. Yeah.
I think everybody should read your compilation on the Holy Spirit, because this summarizes the truth. And the truth is that when we teach the cause, and you're teaching the cause right now, when you teach the history of the cause, you're teaching the cause, the Holy Spirit is working through us, period. So there's we shouldn't even think for a minute about ego, because it has nothing to do with me. It has everything to do with God and what his will is. And his will is being accomplished through this sensory approach, which is, it's just really spectacular. And it's overwhelming sometimes, I have to tell you, emotionally. When I read a book about the faith and the history, it doesn't hit me emotionally the way your presentation does. And it's because it's your emotion part of it, but it's also the visuals. The visuals are so amazing to be able to see all these original documents and pictures of the boats that he took and the donkey he rode on. And, which one of us have had that opportunity before?
Yeah, it's kind of like reading like a illustrated. Yeah, I mean, that's the whole idea with the illustrated chronology, I mean, it was really for me, it was like, I was writing the history and I couldn't do it. It was really hard for me to do. And then as soon as I started putting images to it, I was like, oh, wow, this is a lot easier. And then, I mean, it's just the way my mind works. And I'm lucky that it's the way everybody's mind works. This is a really originally selfish thing for me, but it works for others. That's cool. That works. I have a question for the Persians. First of all, Lucinda was about to say something. Lucinda, what were you about to say?
I agree about the emotion, the presentation you do with the emotions that you have around these topics and around these, how you brought these, you have all these memories of bringing all this information together and how exciting it was and how daunting or how sad or how fun or how interesting that process is, which you bring when you share to a certain degree. It just comes out. And that was the part that I, you know, I agree. When I read, it's kind of, all the details are overwhelming, but the images that you slip in there, they're just fabulous. I mean, they just have so much intricacy and just bring you to the moment. I mean, I felt like I was slipping along on my donkey behind Baha'u'llah, you know?
Yeah.
And same. You just don't get that in any other way.
Same. I could even, when I was writing about the donkeys, I could even hear them clip-clopping, you know? I could hear their hooves on the road, you know?
Yeah.
Thank you. That's good. I mean, it's good to, you guys are like a mirror, you know, and you're like reflecting back. So I appreciate that. I was wondering if anyone has Persian background that can help us answer a question that's in the chat here. Carol asks, where are the women? All the pictures that we saw for the memorial, for the funeral, for the burial, they were all men. Where were the women? Did the women have separate gatherings? Were they not invited? Does anyone know? I don't know, actually. This is really, really amazing because I never even noticed. Does anyone know? Go ahead, Joyce.
Yeah, I have no Persian background and I have nothing other than all those people needed to be cared for and fed. I think the women were in the kitchen being of service.
Oh my God.
But they had to be. They had to be. I'm sure they had their own gatherings.
Yeah.
When you have all of those mourners coming and I mean, I cannot even imagine it with microwaves and ovens. Another thing I was going to say is that I had to miss some of the sessions. And so I went back and looked at the videos. And what I did was I did a split screen. I did your presentations here that you've been doing. And then I did the utterance project chronologies on the other screen. Mm-hmm. So I could listen to you and then stop you and then go read on my other screen.
That's a good idea.
Or click on and follow the links. It took me forever, but it really also even enhanced. I can't imagine how long it took you to do this. But it enhanced it for me as well. It helped
That's
me.
That's a great in another idea. Way.
And
because what Peter was saying, you listen and you look, but then you do.
Right. Yeah. And it allows you to sort of understand it in your own unique way as well. And I want to echo what Lucin and Peter said. And I mean, I was a teacher for 50 years. So yes, this is the way people learn. And this is what all this technology was given to the world to do. Things like you're doing. And you're a real pioneer in this. And just think about
years,
the groundwork
amazing.
That you're laying for future educators and historians.
Wow. So you're all in touch with me. So you all know that you can write to me whenever you want and, make me suggestions. If I can improve this in any way I'm going to be presenting it the same way for Shoghi Effendi. So let me know if there's anything I can do better. I wanted to say that I think that Joyce is right about these women. I think probably the women, I think two things must have happened, you know, and this is, of course, I'm imagining, but I'm basing it on two facts in history. The two times in history where we mention women is being apart like this is when Baha'u'llah is in the Garden of Rizwan and he's left the Most Great House for the last time. And he's on this island, he's on this Garden of Rizwan with the Baha'is that he's declaring his mission to, right? We don't know what happens the first 9 days, but we know that the waters flood and they're kind of isolated. And the women and the Holy Family and all the women are back in Baghdad cooking for them the whole time, getting like boatloads of Persian food delivered. We know that. That's in King of Glory by Head of the Cause, Mr. Balyuzi. And also, when Baha'u'llah dies, the ascension of Baha'u'llah, there are 9 days of mourning. And we know that the Holy Family, headed by Abdu'l-Bahá, but the women of the Holy Family are the ones who are cooking for all the mourners for those 9 days. So this we have also information about. So that's what makes me think that Joyce is absolutely right. And I remember when Abdu'l-Bahá came back from the Holy Land, at first he met with the women and children and the elderly, and then they left, and then he met with the men. I'm assuming there's a similar structure here, you know, where the women would not have just been put in front of the ovens to cook after Abdu'l-Bahá died. They would have had some time to cry and been together, you know? So there must have had been some things. But you know what? These are really, really, really fascinating things. And for future historians, you know, future women, Persian and Arabic speaking and Turkish speaking historians, they're going to uncover these things. You know, I have to say one more time, please buy Bahariye Ruhiye Mani's Leaves of the Twin Divine Trees. It is life-changing, and I do not use that word lightly. When I discovered that book, thank God Adib Masumian, who's like my co-creator of the Utterance Project. I could not have done anything without him. He introduced me to this book before I started even writing the first chronology, and it was in my brain that nothing you do is going to have any kind of texture if you don't add women to it. So, because what happens with the women is that you have the women, you have the children, you have the food, and there's so much gentleness that gets folded into the life of the Bab, Baha'u'llah, Abdu'l-Bahá, and then Shoghi Effendi too, because one of the things that I just love is that the Bab, Baha'u'llah, Abdu'l-Bahá, and Shoghi Effendi, the four successive centers of the covenant, what they have in common is they have incredible wives. Incredible wives that served, that wrote books, that helped martyrs' widows, that went around the world talking, that wrote their autobiographies, you know? And so for each of these centers of the covenant, you have a tax on the covenant, but each of them at one point has on their side their wife. You know, like when Baha'u'llah left from Constantinople, he was in the same howdah as Asiye Khanum. You know, when the Bab was married to Khadija Begum, he talked to her like a modern marriage, you know? And Abdu'l-Bahá had 50 years of marriage with Munira Khanum. Just, oh God. So that's an area in Baha'i studies that's gonna grow so much in the next 50 years. Mm-hmm. I don't want to leave you guys, but it's time.
Violetta, before you go, I have a really quick question.
Yes, go ahead, Jim.
I'm going to be at Desert Rose with the Dawnbreakers.
Oh.
Can Terry or somebody tell me or email me the way I download it on my computer? I don't know where. Do I go to Baha'i Reference Library and then can I download it? Oh,
good question. Good question. Jim, I have your email.
Okay.
I will put you in touch with Chad. How's that?
Oh yeah, I can ask Chad.
Okay. Sounds good. Oh, I wish I was with you guys. That sounds amazing.
Thank you very, very much for this. This has been wonderful.
It's been an honor. It's been such an honor. I've been looking forward to this. It's going to be so different without this. But you guys, let's stay in touch. Okay.
Thank you.
Allah. 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 Love you guys.